Hello friends, I'm at UL headquarters in Northbrook, Illinois, where today we're going to learn a little bit about something called dielectric testing. Oh, and speaking of electric testing, our friends from the UL lab in Melville, New York had one more message that they wanted to share with us. Finally, we're going to come back here to Northbrook to visit our hazardous locations lab. Sounds like a pretty busy day, huh? You ready? Let's go. So I'm in the industrial controls lab here at UL, and I'm here with Carol. Say hi, Carol.
Hi, Carol.
All right, Carol, so what do you do here at UL?
As a UL engineer, I test and evaluate products to make sure that there's no risk of shock or fire, primarily.
Oh, okay, and why is that so important?
Safety is important. People trust that products that they purchase with our mark on it won't harm them or their families or their homes or the environment, so it's very important.
Great. Now, what kind of test do we have here?
The test that I have here is called a dielectric voltage withstand test, and essentially what it does, it demonstrates the ability of something that's connected to a high voltage, such as plugging into the 120 volt outlet in your home, is going to be safe on the end that would, for example, plug into your phone or your laptop.
What does this machine do?
This machine will actually tell us if there's a shock hazard in the equipment, because it'll indicate if there's a dielectric breakdown between this high voltage side that plugs into the wall and the low voltage side, which would plug into your cell phone.
Oh, okay. And how do we just run the power from here to here?
We do. We actually connect one side of the lead to the high voltage side, and then we connect the second lead to the low voltage side, and we see if we can get any current to flow between the two. And if there is current flow, we're going to get a red light here to show that it was a test failure.
Okay, great. Is it okay if we try to run the test?
It's okay if we do the test right now, Dennis, absolutely.
Okay, perfect.
All right, Dennis, so we've got attached to one side of the device, the side that plugs into our outlet in our home, where you'd see about 120 volts, and the other side of the tester on the low voltage side. And we're gonna pump 3,000 volts from here to here and see if we can get the voltage to jump from one side to the other. And we'd see that because the machine would indicate a dielectric breakdown.
Okay.
Are you ready, Dennis?
Yes, let's try it.
All right, let's go. And you saw the spark, you see the indication of failure, which means the product does not have the isolation. It is a shock hazard.
Okay, wow, so this one would not pass the test.
This would not pass the test. It would not comply with the UL safety requirements.
All right, perfect. Well, thank you very much for explaining that.
You're welcome, Dennis.
It's time for a new segment called Fun Facts and Learned Lessons, brought to you by UL Safety Smart.
Wait, what are we doing?
It's a new idea.
Okay, let's try it.
Way back when they first started putting wires in people's houses, they came up with this little screw-in Edison-based fuse. The problem with the fuse was that if you had a problem at night and the hardware stores were closed and you ran out of fuses, people would unscrew the fuse and stick a penny inside of it.
Huh, why would they do that?
Because they wanted the electricity back on.
Oh, so that would make it come back.
It would make it closed circuit, the electricity would come back on. But the problem here now is you have no fire protection.
Oh.
So if you overheated your wires, this fuse would not open, the penny would stay on, and now you set the wires in your walls on fire, which would burn down your house.
Right.
Okay. Then some nice gentleman years later developed basically a resettable fuse called a circuit breaker. So when this guy trips, it turns off the power, and then you remove your fault, you can turn it back on, and now you have electricity, and you don't have to worry about sticking a penny in here and causing a fire hazard.
Fun facts and learned lessons.
All right, so now I'm in the hazardous locations lab, and I'm here with Tim. Say hi, Tim.
Hi, Tim.
Oh, come on. Now, what do you do here at the hazardous locations lab?
I specifically, I'm a senior laboratory technician. So we specifically test the actual samples that we get from clients that come into UL.
Oh, okay, great. Now, can you explain a little bit more about what's going on here?
Absolutely. So we'll take what we call a sample. Now, it could be anything from a motor, could be anything from a light fixture, but these particular samples that we test are normally found in a hazardous location or a location that will consist of combustible gases or combustible dust. So we will take this a sample that we get in, we will drill and tap it for our piping system, and we will hook it up to our valve stands, which will fill it with combustible gas, with explosive gases, and we will also provide a surrounding atmosphere around that particular sample. So when we ignite the sample inside, when we cause an explosion inside of the sample, it will actually, the sample will either contain the explosion or the flame path will come outside of the explosion and ignite the surrounding atmosphere, and that's how we know if it blows up, that's how we know a sample actually failed.
I was not allowed to be in the testing area during the actual test, and this was done for multiple reasons, the most important of which is safety. Also, we were not able to record video of the actual sample while it was being tested, but Tim was kind enough to give us a small tour of the Hazardous Locations Lab. He showed us more of what he does in the lab, and he explained the computerized control center. However, after seeing these tools and these wooden boxes on the far side of the lab, I asked Tim to tell us how they are used and why are they there in the first place.
So this box, we have our sample housed inside. Mm-hmm. The purpose of the box is to encapsulate and create a surrounding atmosphere around your sample. The explosions that we cause within the samples themselves have to contain the explosion inside of the sample. When we ignite the gas inside of the sample, it has to stay inside the sample. The reason we build a box around it is to create a surrounding atmosphere. We cover the top of it with the plastic. If in fact the sample fails, the explosion comes outside of the sample, it will ignite the surrounding gas atmosphere around it, and it will blow the top of the box off. That's how we know we have a failure.
So now that we know what these wooden boxes are used for, here is a short clip of an actual test performed in the lab. Yep, this is what a failed sample in the Hazardous Locations Lab looks like. So today here at the UL lab in Northbrook, Illinois, we learned about dielectric testing and why it's so important. We learned about circuit breakers and why it's so important to use them as opposed to using a penny. And finally, we visited the Hazardous Locations Lab. So overall, today was actually a really good day. For UL Safety Smart, I'm Dennis Avalar, and that's how you learn.